From Midnight to Dawn, The Last Tracks of the Underground Railroad, by Jacqueline Tobin with Hettie Jones. Narrated by Richard Allen. Copyright 2007 by Jacqueline L. Tobin. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Doubleday, an imprint of the Doubleday Broadway Publishing Group, a division of Random House Incorporated, and was produced in the year 2007 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Preface. One More River to Cross. At the center of One Hard Plaza in Detroit, Michigan, where United States land ends at the Detroit River, a group of larger-than-life-size bronze figures bear witness to one half of a shared story. Standing with them, following their gaze across the river, a few hundred yards away you can see Windsor, Ontario, in Canada, where the other half of the story took place, and where similar figures are part of a companion monument. Even at first glance, both groups reveal the central fact in the story. On the U.S. side, the figures, men, women, and children, face north toward Canada, and from the look of them, you know they're anxious to get there. Yet their anticipation is tinged with uncertainty and a vague weariness. The monument in Windsor shows another group, this one newly arrived. They're being greeted and they seem thankful, if still hesitant and unsure of what awaits. Only one little girl, holding a doll, is looking back towards something, or, more likely, someone she has left behind. For a while during the 19th century, the city of Detroit had a code name, Midnight. Fugitive slaves passed through there in secrecy on their way to Canada, sometimes with the help of sympathetic contacts, but more often alone, with little information and without any assistance from others. In either case, they were always in danger. If they were lucky, there was aid on both sides. But what has come to be known as the Underground Railroad was less an organized system than a corridor of subterfuge and chance, and if there were sometimes conductors, safe houses, and tickets to ride, there were also arduous nights in the mountains and days in strange, threatening towns. There was no easy path out of slavery to freedom. For those who made it to Midnight, the Detroit River became their Jordan, the One More River to Cross, they'd long sung about. On the other side lay their Land of Canaan and the liberty that still eluded Africans in the United States. For a period of time before the Civil War, even in so-called free states, fugitives could be hunted down and once more enslaved. But that did not stop thousands from running away. From Windsor, the new arrivals traveled to several black settlements, among them one known as Dawn, where they lived freely under the protection of British law. There, in these places, the story continues. Before the Civil War, more than 30,000 people crossed into Canada, many of them from Midnight to Dawn, some more than once as they returned to help others. Some of the fugitives who reached Canada stayed on after the Civil War, others returned to the States. But in the passage, all learned through education and economic self-determination the ways they might live free. Their story is neither a uniquely American story or separately a Canadian story, but one that forever unites the two countries and people. It is a story of desperation and resistance, of courage and survival, of men and women who risked their own lives in order to claim the life that they and they alone owned. Communication among these settlers was common and considerable, with much travel from one location to another undertaken not only by residents, but by interested visitors. The existence of a network of Canadian communities of escaped slaves and refugee free people of color was, of course, known in the United States. Newspapers reported about them. Abolitionist leaders referred to them. They did not all exist simultaneously during the half century before the Civil War, but large, small, separate, or part of existing towns and cities, they were familiar destinations to all the well-known figures, black and white, whose public positions against slavery inspired many. Harriet Tubman, Frederick Douglass, John Brown, and Harriet Beecher Stowe all knew about, experienced, and wrote about Dawn, Wilberforce, Chatham, and the other places whose stories are told here. Also, and very importantly, lesser known to most Americans, but effective activists contributed to the founding and organization of the Promised Lands in Canada, where black people at last were able to direct their lives. There they practiced agriculture, established and expanded schools, factories, businesses, and places of worship, created civic structures, and published newspapers to keep themselves informed. They argued over whether to become totally self-sufficient or to accept help, but overall they wanted to live as free people and be judged accordingly. The histories of these Canadian settlements, like the lives of their residents, overlap, but each was unique in origin, organizing principle, and progress, a story in itself. Their individual successes and failures have been up to now absent from American histories, and until recently from Canadian histories as well. From Midnight to Dawn sets them out here, stories from the 19th century shedding light on the 21st. Introduction: Freedom's New Direction. In the 85 years between the American Revolution and the Civil War, not only the North and South of the United States, but all of North America struggled with the issue of slavery. The Declaration of Independence had set a standard. All men are created equal, and the colonies had responded passionately to this promise of a new egalitarian society. Yet there remained over 500,000 enslaved Africans toiling on American lands. In addition, living throughout the country were 25,000 free blacks, men and women of African descent who were born free or who had served, earned, purchased, or escaped their way to freedom. The pervasive spirit of liberty and independence was not lost on them. Crispus Attucks, a runaway slave, was the first man to die in the struggle for American independence, though Paul Revere's famous engraving showed him as white. But the British, in need of manpower, had held out counteroffers. In 1775, Lord Dunmore, the royal governor of Virginia, issued a proclamation stating that slaves who sided with the British would be granted their freedom after the war. Within 1 month, more than 300 enslaved black men had responded to Dunmore's call, the first mass emancipation of slaves in American history. These black loyalists, as they were called, wore uniforms emblazoned with the slogan, "Liberty to Slaves," which became not just a black, but also a British rallying cry, though the British based their offer solely on the need for manpower, not on any abolitionist beliefs. Because Lord Dunmore's call had been such a successful tactic, the British found themselves committed to the concept of freeing slaves owned by the rebellious Americans, who were called patriots, as opposed to loyalists. This economic tactic, used in conjunction with military tactics, worked. No one knows exactly how many slaves fled to safety behind British military lines after Dunmore's proclamation, but it is likely that more than 100,000 free and enslaved blacks eventually found their way there. Thomas Jefferson is said to have estimated that 30,000 were lost in Virginia alone. Loss of slave manpower hurt the patriots, who responded with intimidation. Many slave owners threatened severe punishment to runaways. The Virginia Assembly attempted to control the slaves in the colony it governed by threatening them with death if they were caught trying to escape. Southern newspapers printed misinformation about British intentions to sell runaways after the war to sugar plantations in the West Indies. Despite the appeal of the British offers, more than 5,000 black patriots like Crispus Attucks fought for independence. That number might have increased, but in the South, where enslaved blacks often outnumbered whites and memories of armed insurrections were vivid, the enlistment of blacks was severely opposed. Instead, taking a lesson from the British, patriots began to free slaves from loyalist farms and plantations. Again, military and economic needs, rather than abolitionist ideas, motivated these acts of emancipation. In 1780, another North American black man entered the historical record. Enslaved at age 16 when he was captured in what is now Senegal, Richard Pierpoint later joined the war for independence as a loyalist. He is listed in military records as a member of the infamous Butler's Rangers, a select group of men skilled in guerrilla warfare as well as in traditional military tactics. Pierpoint felt his loyalties lay with a country that was at least offering the hope of freedom, and he was eventually rewarded. For his services on behalf of the crown, he received a grant of 200 acres of land in what eventually became St. Catharines, Ontario, where the legendary Harriet Tubman would later bring her family to freedom. The American Revolution officially ended with the Treaty of Paris in 1783. Loyalists, both black and white, were forced to leave. Many former slaves chose to move to the West Indies, but others went north. Most considered themselves Americans and did not want to leave the continent. Going to Canada was actually the easiest geographical location to move to without losing ties to family and friends. More than 3,000 free blacks had settled in Nova Scotia by the end of 1783. Reparations and the return of lost property were conditions of the treaty. Since the Americans considered slaves to be property, they demanded compensation for their losses and the return of their slaves. The British balked. British commanders had guaranteed freedom to all slaves who had fought for their side. They held firm in their belief that justice required them to honor their offer and insisted that black loyalists be evacuated along with all others, since they had been free under British rule at the time the treaty was signed. The British did, however, offer to compensate the former slave owners. In order to determine numbers, a Book of Negroes was created, which documented all blacks being given free passage to British lands. They were also given certificates of freedom to prove their new status. In the former colonies, now known as the United States of America, weeks of celebration surrounded the election of the victorious General George Washington as the first president of the new nation. But the euphoria didn't last. There were many challenges, foremost among them finding a way to save the Union. 13 separate colonies had come together with one purpose. Keeping them united required fortitude as well as fervor. Differences among individual states were already surfacing, the most serious and divisive being the issue of slavery. In the North, where revolutionary zeal had been strongest, citizens had begun to question the institution of slavery itself. Many could not reconcile throwing off their own yokes while still enslaving thousands of blacks. Gradual emancipation acts were passed in the northern states. By the first few years of the 19th century, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, New York, Connecticut, Rhode Island, and Vermont had all abolished slavery altogether. Meanwhile, the states continued to disagree. In 1787, a constitutional convention was called. Delegates felt that individual states held too much power, but at the same time they were wary of granting too much power to the federal government. A balance was sought. Since some states had large populations and others small, representation in the government became a critical issue. Southerners, in order to bolster their numbers, wanted slaves counted as whole people. Northerners felt this would give the southern states too much control. Compromises were reached to placate each area. Northern states agreed to continue the importation of slaves for another 20 years until 1808, when it would then be outlawed. Southern states agreed that each slave would count as only 3/5 of a person for representation purposes. The Northwest Ordinance carved up the newly acquired northwestern lands gained from Great Britain, which now include Ohio, Indiana, Illinois, Michigan, Wisconsin, and parts of Minnesota, forbidding slavery there but adding fugitive slave rules allowing for the pursuit of runaways. On September 17, 1787, the final draft of the United States Constitution was signed by 39 of the delegates to the convention, including the convention's president, George Washington, who stated in his letter to Congress the hope of the framers, that it may promote the lasting welfare of that country so dear to us all, and secure her freedom and happiness, is our most ardent wish. Hopes for the new country were high. Britain, too, had been caught up in the fever of egalitarianism that had swept the American colonies toward independence. Emancipation of enslaved blacks during the war was soon followed by legislation in support of it, this time based not on wartime expedience, but on rising abolitionism. And there remained a British presence in North America, Canada. The year 1793 was pivotal. Three events within a few months of one another set in motion subsequent events that pointed to Canada as the land of Canaan, and eventually culminated in the Civil War. In July, John Graves Simcoe, Upper Canada's first lieutenant governor and an ardent abolitionist, succeeded in passing the first Canadian provincial act against slavery. While the act did not actually free anyone, it stated that no more slaves could be introduced into the province, which later became Ontario. The act also provided that those currently enslaved would remain so until death, and that children born after the act was passed would become free at the age of 25, thus ensuring the eventual eradication of slavery in the province. Also, in 1793, Eli Whitney, an American schoolteacher, invented the cotton gin, a machine for removing seeds from harvested cotton, which gave the South a tremendous economic boost but required increased slave labor. The cotton gin ensured that in the American South, slavery would become entrenched. Before then, cotton and slavery were not historically intertwined. Virginia and Kentucky grew tobacco. Rice was cultivated in the low country areas of South Carolina and Georgia. Sugar reigned as king in Louisiana, but the invention of the cotton gin not only revitalized a sagging southern economy, it changed the course of American history. In the ensuing 7 years, cotton production would increase more than tenfold. What had been a minor cash crop was to become the road to riches. All you needed was a large plantation and a large number of slaves to work it. Solid economic and political divisions were now created between the North and the South. Although foreign slave trade was to be outlawed as of 1808, the South's rising need for cheap labor simply shifted the trade from foreign to domestic. Cities such as New Orleans would become major venues for the buying and selling of slaves. It is estimated that over 700,000 slaves were eventually moved in a massive domestic migration from the North to the South, which now had an enormous economic interest in the institution of slavery and took measures to protect it. The third event of 1793 was a step taken by Congress to try to hold the South in the young American nation, despite rising objections to slavery. Known as the First Fugitive Slave Act, it made aiding escapees a crime. The problem of runaways was as old as the institution of slavery. Before the Revolution, pacts between the colonies addressed the return of escapees. Afterward, Southerners succeeded in inserting the following fugitive slave clause into the Constitution. No person held to service or labor in one state under the laws thereof, escaping into another, shall, in consequence of any law or regulation therein, be discharged from such servitude or labor, but shall be delivered up on claim of the party to whom such service or labor may be due. But no enforcement powers had been granted the federal government until the Fugitive Slave Act of 1793, which empowered slave owners to arrest alleged fugitives and fine anyone harboring fugitives or aiding their escape. There was no provision in this law to protect those unlawfully accused, so kidnapping of free blacks as well as fugitives would soon become common. After 1793, the North and South struggle escalated. Free states faced off against slave states, the latter augmented by the expansion of U.S. territory with the Louisiana Purchase in 1803, and, eventually, the annexation of Texas in 1845, opening up new lands to the cultivation of cotton and the practice of slavery. To every new pro-slavery law enacted on the federal level by Southerners, Northern states responded with counteractive state legislation. From 1780 to 1861, Northern states passed personal liberty laws that would protect free blacks from possible kidnappings, barred state officials from enforcing fugitive slave laws, and offered fugitives all the protections of due process, including trial by jury. Up until the War of 1812, when the United States declared war on Britain for its repeated seizures of American ships and sailors, those wishing to escape had no clear direction. Without knowledge of geography and distance, or even political climate, many runaways escaped into the swamps or just outside plantation perimeters, often only to return to their families and familiar ground back on the plantations. After the war, returning soldiers, as well as the slaves who had accompanied them to British lands in Canada, brought back word of places up north where blacks were living freely. Freedom now had a clear direction and a destination. Chapter 1. Wilberforce. A new black consciousness arose in the decades after the War of 1812. Faced with increased discrimination and violence against them, blacks were no longer waiting for sympathetic whites to protect their interests, but began working actively on their own behalf. Vigilance committees were formed for mutual support and protection. Black abolitionist newspapers appeared, representing the thoughts of many free blacks who did not want whites speaking for them. Fraternal organizations, such as the Prince Hall Masons, which had been in existence since the American Revolution, became even more prominent and proactive. When an underground railroad was laid on the paths first trod by courageous forebearers who had escaped without any white assistance, many of the conductors were free blacks. The term is believed to derive from the story of a young fugitive named Tice Davids, who in 1831 crossed the Ohio River with his master following in a boat close behind. Supposedly, when Davids reached the Ohio shore, he disappeared and his master could not find him. The master returned to his home in Kentucky, claiming that Davids must have escaped by way of an underground railroad. The railroad metaphor continued, as helpers eventually were called conductors. Fugitives became parcels and passengers, and safe houses were referred to as stations. Black immigration, an issue since the early 19th century, was now being discussed and redefined by blacks who wanted to decide their own destiny. The movement had begun in 1816 with the American Colonization Society, which included both whites and blacks as members, and was an attempt to effect a compromise between those who owned slaves and those who wanted to free them. The idea was to send free blacks elsewhere rather than emancipate them into the United States population. Established and run for the most part by white men, the society included such notable Americans as Henry Clay, the Speaker of the House, Francis Scott Key, the attorney and author of the Star-Spangled Banner, and Bushrod Washington, a Supreme Court justice and the nephew of George Washington. Liberia, established on the west coast of Africa, was the society's biggest success. By the 1820s, though, most blacks considered themselves Americans, not Africans, and immigration to Africa was no longer a desirable outcome. Many of our fathers and some of us have fought and bled for the liberty, independence, and peace which you now enjoy, wrote one free black in the North. Surely it would be ungenerous and unfeeling in you to deny us a humble and quiet grave in that country which gave us birth. Although the American Colonization Society continued until the end of the Civil War, it did so with diminishing support from the black population it was meant to serve. The very definition of freedom itself had evolved. While it had once meant simply escaping slavery to a state where slavery had been abolished, it now included the concepts of equality under the law, freedom of opportunity, and freedom from discrimination and violence. And the growing numbers of blacks moving to northern states began to force the issue. Events in southern Ohio in 1829 would serve to emphasize these problems, but they also had far-reaching consequences, including the creation of Wilberforce, the first organized all-black settlement in Upper Canada. Ohio had abolished slavery in 1802, but in the same decade had also passed so-called black laws. Enacted in 1804 and 1807, but rarely enforced, these were harsh attempts to stop the immigration of blacks and to control those already living there. New arrivals were required to register and carry a certificate of freedom, as well as to post a $500 bond within 20 days of entering the state. Still, blacks were drawn there, especially to the city of Cincinnati, right across the Ohio River from Kentucky, a slave state. Fugitives crossed the river to freedom, free blacks to look for work. The construction of the Miami and Erie Canal, which connected Toledo to Cincinnati, increased the demand for steamships to transport goods throughout the Great Lakes regions and required a large labor pool. Both black and white laborers flocked to Cincinnati. In 1802, blacks made up 2% of its population. By the end of the decade, that figure had risen to over 10%. In a city already home to hundreds of unemployed citizens, competition for jobs and an eventual downturn in the economy brought about increased tensions. I thought upon coming to a free state like Ohio that I would find every door thrown open to receive me, wrote John Malvin, a fugitive. But from the treatment I received by the people generally, I found it little better than Virginia. New problems beset the black community, as well as the white population. Denied access to white institutions, blacks attempted to deal with their increasing difficulties by establishing their own associations, but the increased demand for housing and employment could not be satisfied by existing means. There were just not enough resources to go around. Most blacks congregated in Cincinnati's First and Fourth Wards, an area that became known as Little Africa. Segregation, although not legally sanctioned, became the norm. Early black settlers had lived in good, well-built houses, but when newcomers began pouring in, any structure had to do. Shacks and shanties rose, creating health and fire hazards. Whites grew increasingly intolerant. Earlier in the decade, they had made attempts through the Colonization Society to remove blacks from the city in the socially acceptable method popular at the time, but nothing came of the decision. Local newspapers began printing editorials complaining about black people, accusing them of harboring or even kidnapping runaways. Citizens spoke out loudly against the night walkers, lewd persons, and those who lounge about without any visible means of support. While the nighttime activities of whites were probably not that different from those of the blacks accused, it was the latter who bore the brunt of scrutiny and blame. By June 1829, Cincinnati was at the boiling point. Town trustees issued a proclamation, posted ironically on July 4th, stating the city's intent to enforce the black laws of 1804 and 1807. As the hot, sticky summer drew to a close, blacks in Cincinnati were made acutely aware of their precarious situation. Threats of violence increased. Free blacks responded by forming their own group to look for other places to live. "If the act is enforced," wrote one, "we, the poor sons of Ethiopia, must take shelter where we can find it." If we cannot find it in America, where we were born and spent all our days, we must beg it elsewhere. The Cincinnati group chose as their leader James C. Brown, a former slave who had purchased his freedom by hiring himself out as a skilled mason. Having been a member of the American Colonization Society, Brown was well qualified for the task. He had been sent by the Society to Texas to explore setting up a black colony there, and though white opposition had canceled the Texas plans, the experience served him well. Many blacks, like Brown, experiencing segregation, prejudice, and lack of legal standing, were at the outset more than willing to explore colonization elsewhere. As intimidation and threats continued to escalate in Cincinnati, the colonization group decided to send two representatives to Upper Canada to look for a location for an all-black settlement. Even after the Revolution, the Canadian government had continued to extend itself in this respect. Black as well as white veterans of the War of 1812 had been offered land grants in the rolling farmlands northwest of Lake Ontario. Sir Peregrine Maitland, the province's then lieutenant governor, had been trying to protect his territory against an American invasion from Lake Huron and the Georgian Bay. Perhaps he saw the area as a potential sanctuary for runaway slaves from the United States. Since Canada was still a colony of Britain, Maitland could have been adopting a similar anti-slavery stance. It's also possible that he was simply interested in further separating his territory from lands now American. Whatever the motives, many fugitives found the land offered too remote to be easily accessible. Many who were granted land never settled on it. However, one group of 13 did establish Oro, essentially the first assisted settlement of blacks in Canada. Because it was so distant, Oro was abandoned eventually, but the precedent for black settlement in Canada had been established. Bearing a letter from James C. Brown, the Cincinnati group's two representatives, Israel Lewis and Thomas Cressup, met with General John Colburn, then Upper Canada's lieutenant governor, who is reported to have had this response to their request for safe haven. "Tell the Republicans on your side of the line that we royalists do not know men by their color. Should you come to us, you will be entitled to all the privileges of the rest of His Majesty's subjects." The Canada Company had been incorporated by the British Parliament in 1825 to obtain land in Canada and promote its sale to prospective settlers. Lewis and Cressup returned to Cincinnati not only with Colburn's assurances of legal protection, but also an offer by the Canada Company to sell 4,000 acres, only 8 miles from the shores of Lake Erie, for $6,000. The Cincinnati group didn't have the money. They asked the Ohio legislature for help, but were refused. Finally, Quakers from Ohio and Indiana stepped in and purchased 800 acres. Nevertheless, as representatives were completing the land deal, whites in Cincinnati proceeded with their plans to enforce the black laws and rid their town of its black population. Threats of mob violence grew. Writing in the Cincinnati Daily Gazette, Brown pleaded with the city for a 3-month extension. "Withhold your mighty arms until our representatives return. We beg your sympathy until we find shelter." As designated leader of the black population, and aware that it would take time to move over 2,000 people to a new community, Brown did everything in his power to placate the whites until the blacks could leave. He wrote articles for the Gazette to keep the public informed about the black community's plans for immigration to Canada and their efforts thus far. But even this did not satisfy the whites. On August 15, 1829, a mob of 300 attacked the black community, beating the inhabitants and demolishing their homes and businesses. The violence went on for 3 days. Over 1,500 African Americans fled for their lives. Those who left the city fell roughly into two groups, each pushed into immediate action by the violence, but each having different motives. As historian Nikki Taylor has noted, some were refugees, escaping the mob violence of Cincinnati, going anywhere for safety. Those led by Brown were immigrants, having already organized and made plans to leave the city to create a new life elsewhere. Some of the refugees moved to cities just outside of Cincinnati, seeking safety close to home. Many even returned later the same year, when the Cincinnati City Fathers realized that they were losing much of their cheap labor pool, and the mayor promised he would try to repeal the black laws. Of those who continued on to Canada, most settled right across the border from Detroit, near the town of Amherstburg. Their goal was to move only far enough away to get outside the reach of American prejudice and violence toward them. But at least 5 families moved on to the lands purchased from the Canada Company and became the nucleus of the settlement that came to be known as Wilberforce. During its nearly 10-year existence, settlers established 2 churches, a temperance society, a grist mill, a sawmill, and schools. One visitor noted that 20 to 30 children were at school. Others made mention that even some white children from the neighboring areas were in attendance. The desire for a quality education superseded any belief in segregation. When James C. Brown left Wilberforce soon after the first settlers arrived, his wife having grown disillusioned with living in Canada, Israel Lewis recruited Austin Stewart, a successful grocer from Rochester, New York. Stewart was supportive of the new settlement. He believed that rural areas, not cities, were the best places for blacks to find opportunity for independence and self-sufficiency. In his memoir, 22 Years a Slave and 40 Years a Freeman, he wrote, "Our people mostly flock to cities where they allow themselves to be made hewers of wood and drawers of water, barbers and waiters, when, if they would but retire to the country and purchase a piece of land, cultivate and improve it, they would be far richer and happier than they can in a crowded city." It was Stewart who had first given the community the name Wilberforce, in honor of William Wilberforce. Known as the Liberator for his 18-year effort to end slavery in the British Empire, Wilberforce deserved the honor. Religious influences had moved him to his abolitionist beliefs, among them John Newton, his rector in London, a reformed slave trader who had been inspired to write the song "Amazing Grace" in testament to his conversion. Just 3 days before Wilberforce died, the House of Commons finally passed the British Emancipation Act. He lived to know that the first organized all-black settlement in Upper Canada had been named for him and that his abolitionist efforts had succeeded. Austin Stewart assumed leadership of Wilberforce, as he had been asked to do, but it became clear that he had taken on the role, at least in some part, to propel himself to a seat in Parliament. Israel Lewis, however, wanted the recognition of leading the community himself. Internal struggles ensued, personally as well as financially. Lewis was eventually accused of absconding with monies he had solicited for the settlement. These problems were aired publicly, affecting what until then had become favorable American press about the community, especially on the part of Benjamin Lundy, a Quaker abolitionist who published The Genius of Universal Emancipation, an anti-slavery newspaper. Before 1830, Lundy had been the foremost figure in the anti-slavery movement in the States. His lifelong efforts influenced many of the early abolitionists of the time, including William Lloyd Garrison, who credited Lundy with awakening him to the holy cause of emancipation. Garrison, writing in his own newspaper, The Liberator, also supported Wilberforce. "As it increases in population, intelligence, and power, it will render the prolongation of that accursed and bloody system more and more insecure, and increase more and more the necessity of abolishing it altogether and without delay." Benjamin Lundy had attended the 1823 meeting of the American Convention for Promoting the Abolition of Slavery, where he became acquainted with anti-slavery pamphlets from Britain circulating at the time. He began reprinting them in his paper as he received them, keeping Americans abreast of the rising tide of British anti-slavery efforts. In addition to his work as a publisher, Lundy was an agent of the American Colonization Society, and in his newspaper actively promoted its positions. He began looking toward British North American lands for possible locations for colonization efforts, though he made it very clear that his motivation was in freeing the slaves, not getting rid of them. In 1832, Lundy decided to see for himself what conditions for blacks were like in Upper Canada. He included Wilberforce in his travels. While at a meeting there, he witnessed firsthand the community's internal conflicts. Despite this experience, he printed a hearty endorsement of the settlement when he returned home, writing glowingly about the fertile land surrounding it, the legal protections offered by the British government, and the mild climate of the area. He even sold a map drawn by one Hezekiah Grice, which showed routes that could be used to travel there. In his diary, Lundy prophesied that of the black settlements in Canada, Wilberforce would be by far the most important, as there are men of known intelligence and public spirit there who will give it a consequence that probably will not, at least very soon, be attached to the others. It will indeed be viewed by the colored people as a nucleus for an extensive immigration from the northern and middle parts of the Union, especially from Virginia and several contiguous states. But Lundy's prophecy was never realized. Despite his attempts, as well as those of other abolitionists, to promote the community, records reveal that Wilberforce was never home to more than 200 people. Blacks did not flock there as expected, and the reduction of the original land sale hadn't set a good precedent for relations between the settlers and the Canada Company. There had also been pressure from newly arriving Irish immigrants, who petitioned the company to not sell any more land to blacks. The company's subsequent refusal to extend the original acreage effectively curtailed the settlement's continued growth. Members of Wilberforce's original community scattered, some back to the United States. By 1878, only 4 of the original settlers remained in the area. Nevertheless, before its demise less than 10 years from its inception, and despite its failure to live up to expectations, Wilberforce became a symbol and inspiration for anti-slavery and abolitionist causes. Hezekiah Grice, who had created the map of the route to the settlement, wrote a letter to national black leaders in the states asking whether it was now time to consider immigration en masse to Canada. His question prompted black leaders to come together in Philadelphia on September 15, 1830, for the first National Negro Convention, beginning an institution, the National Negro Convention movement, that was to last for the next 30 years. This first gathering lasted 10 days and hosted over 40 prominent blacks from all over the country. Presiding over the convention was Richard Allen, a former slave who had become a respected leader of Philadelphia's black community. In 1787, Allen and his friend Absalom Jones had broken away from St. George's Methodist Episcopal Church in Philadelphia when refused seating on its main floor. Some blacks followed Jones and formed the African Protestant Episcopal Church of St. Thomas. Others followed Allen to found the African Methodist Episcopal Church, of which he would be elected bishop. Delegates to the first convention outlined their objectives in the creation of a more permanent organization, the American Society of Free Persons of Color, for the purpose of improving their condition in the United States, for purchasing lands, and for the establishment of settlement in the province of Canada. This position made clear that colonization outside North America was no longer seen as acceptable, but that immigration to North American British-held lands would be encouraged. Although supporting immigration to Canada, delegates also declared their intention to work for better conditions in the United States. At the convention's close, Richard Allen wrote an address on behalf of the delegates to Free Persons of Color of these United States, in which he referred to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness as incontrovertible facts, and concluded that our forlorn and deplorable situation earnestly and loudly demand of us to devise and pursue all legal means for the speedy elevation of ourselves and brethren to the scale and standing of men. Allen's address credited the African Colonization Society, but emphasized that the convention's position differed. We beg leave to say that it does not meet with our approbation. Delegates instead made a clear distinction between colonization imposed on them by others and immigration on their own terms, recommending only the formation of a settlement in the British province of Upper Canada, which would be a great advantage of the people of color. Accordingly, the delegates pledged to aid each other by all honorable means to plant and support one in that country. The address was, as Allen stated, an appeal to our colored brethren and to all philanthropists here and elsewhere to assist in this benevolent and important work. Today, what remains of Wilberforce is a plaque and a subdivision called Wilberforce Heights in the town now named Lucan, in honor of the Irish who continued to settle the area. The plaque credits fugitive slaves for the founding. No mention is made of James C. Brown and the group of Cincinnati blacks who had first envisioned this free all-black settlement and took the necessary steps to create it. Nevertheless, the legacy of Wilberforce is not that it failed, but that it happened at all. Not only was it the first organized black settlement in Canada, it also indirectly inspired the national scale of the Negro Convention movement. The shackles of slavery were being shed mentally as well as physically. It took another 10 years, but what had begun in Wilberforce impelled others and opened new doors. And though there were to be more ambitious and successful black settlements in Upper Canada, Wilberforce holds a special position. As historian Fred Landon has written, none of the others attracted more attention or had fixed upon them higher hopes. Even across the sea, there were people watching this experiment in Negro colonization. Its failure was probably inevitable. All the Negro colonies in Upper Canada disappeared as such in time, but while they lasted, they were one of the indirect influences undermining the system of slavery in the United States. Chapter 2. Dawn and Uncle Tom. By 1834, colonization versus abolition was a hot topic throughout the United States, debated most passionately on college campuses. Students at Lane Theological Seminary in Cincinnati were no exception. Lane was a Presbyterian-affiliated school. Its purpose, the education of young men for Christian ministry. Its president, the well-respected Reverend Lyman Beecher, father of Harriet Beecher Stowe, who would later write Uncle Tom's Cabin. Students at Lane had already founded extracurricular clubs for discussing pertinent subjects, such as missions and colonization. Now they petitioned the board of the college to create an anti-slavery society. Dr. Beecher approved, but the trustees didn't, fearing loss of funding and an impact on recruitment of new students. Professors, while privately supporting the idea, advised the students against any action that might create divisions within the student body. While Dr. Beecher was traveling on seminary business, the Lane trustees ordered the students to discontinue both anti-slavery and colonization societies. Beecher's position when he returned was that he didn't want to suppress the students' right to free discussion on any topic of their choice. Nevertheless, faced with the determination of the trustees, he asked the students to bide their time until the new rule could be overturned. But the students refused to back down and asked for the right to transfer without penalty to other seminaries of their choice. A statement of reasons, signed by 51 of them, laid out their beliefs. Many of the Lane rebels, as they were called, relocated across Ohio to the more liberal Oberlin Theological Seminary after receiving assurances of their right to free speech there. The students' bold action caused much public reaction. Newspaper articles condemned them and accused them of trying to infuse politics into a Christian seminary. Theodore D. Weld, one of the Lane rebels, responded, "But in solemn earnest, I ask, why should not theological students investigate and discuss the sin of slavery? Is it not the business of theological seminaries to educate the heart as well as the head? To mellow the sympathies and deepen the emotions, as well as to provide the means of knowledge? If not, then give Lucifer a professorship." Hiram Wilson, another one of the Lane rebels who had transferred, graduated from Oberlin in 1836 and immediately began his mission work. Oberlin's president, Charles Finney, was interested in the status of blacks who had made their way to Canada. He gave Wilson $25 to travel to Upper Canada to investigate and report back on their status. Wilson traveled throughout the province from the fall through the following spring, when he returned to the United States to attend a meeting of the American Anti-Slavery Society as a delegate from Upper Canada. Wilson had a firm personal belief in the importance of education for everyone, especially former fugitives. During his travels, he observed firsthand the discrimination they were facing. Specific educational opportunities for them had to be created, he reported. Wilson solicited financial help from this group, and with five other Oberlin students, he returned to Canada to create schools primarily for, but not restricted to, black students, under the auspices of his new organization, the Canada Mission. Wilson's efforts drew the attention of James Fuller, a Quaker philanthropist in New York State. Fuller, although interested in aiding in the rehabilitation of former fugitives, was reluctant to interfere in the internal affairs of a foreign country. Wilson's Canada Mission gave him the opportunity he was looking for. He began raising money for the schools. At about the same time Hiram Wilson was attending Lane Seminary in Cincinnati, arguing the right to have campus discussions about slavery, Josiah Henson, a fugitive slave from Kentucky, was making his escape through the same city and finding his way across Lake Erie to Canada. Henson had been born in 1789 to slave parents on a farm near Port Tobacco, Maryland. His first memory was of seeing his father walking toward him, bleeding profusely from a beating. He'd struck back at an overseer who had assaulted Henson's mother. As a result, his father was sold south. Henson, his mother, and six siblings continued to live on the same farm until their master drowned while stumbling home drunk. To settle the estate, the Henson family was sold off separately. In his autobiography, written in 1849, Henson wrote, "I remember being torn from a dear and affectionate mother. I saw her tears and heard her groans. From a little boy up, I have remembered my mother. I have heard her pray for me, for she was a good Christian woman before I was born." At 18, allowed to hear a sermon, Henson had a conversion experience that drew him toward a life of preaching. When he was 22, he married a woman from a neighboring plantation. They had 12 children, 7 of whom reached adulthood. At one point during his 41 years of enslavement, Henson suffered a crippling injury from a beating. Both shoulder blades were broken as a result, but no physician was ever called. "From that day to this," he wrote, "I have been unable to raise my hands as high as my head." Despite this disability, he tried to purchase freedom for himself and his family, but after he had saved the necessary funds, his master asked a higher price and set out with Henson to sell him south. During their journey, when his master fell ill, Henson nursed him back to health, despite having had the opportunity to kill him and flee. Henson, whose faith guided him all his life, felt that a Christian would not commit murder, even though he traveled back to the plantation knowing that at the first opportunity, an effort would be made to sell him again. Once at home with his family, Henson made up his mind. On a Saturday night in mid-September 1830, He, his wife, and four of their children escaped. Henson carried the two youngest in a knapsack on his back. They made their way on foot to Cincinnati and on to Sandusky, Ohio, mostly alone, but with some help from Indians and white people they encountered on the way. In Sandusky, Henson met a sympathetic ship captain who took the family across Lake Erie to Buffalo, where they found a man who ferried them to Canada. Describing his elation and relief, Henson wrote, "It was the 28th of October, 1830, in the morning, when my feet first touched the Canada shore. I threw myself on the ground, rolled in the sand, seized handfuls of it, and kissed them, and danced around till in the eyes of several who were present, I passed for a madman." Newly escaped fugitives often settled near the first place they reached, hiring themselves out to white farmers in the area. Initially, the Hensons settled close to Fort Erie. Henson built a small home, worked on local farms, and began preaching to his fellow fugitives who had also settled there. But he soon realized that no progress would be made if they did not become independent through owning their own land. Already seen as a leader as well as a powerful orator, Henson convened a meeting to discuss the issue. They needed energy, enterprise, and self-reliance, he said, and his neighbors agreed. Henson was sent to scout out a suitable location. An area near the Sydenham River, where there was already a small settlement called Dawn, seemed ideal. But first, Henson's group would have to earn money for the purchase of the land, and so they settled temporarily near Colchester, a small community on the southwestern tip of Ontario near Lake Erie, where land was already cleared and they could grow crops to sell. Henson often preached about the important obligations the group was bound to honor, not only to God for their deliverance, but to their fellow men. Always a man who acted on his beliefs, during these years he made numerous trips back to the States to bring other fugitives to Canada. As he would write, "I have been instrumental in delivering 118 human beings out of the cruel and merciless grasp of the slaveholder." It was while living in Colchester that Henson met Hiram Wilson and was eventually introduced to James Fuller. In June 1838, Wilson and Henson called a convention of Canadian blacks to discuss the establishment of a school. "Our children could gain those elements of knowledge which are usually taught in a grammar school," Henson urged. "In addition, boys should be taught the practice of a mechanical art, like millwork, carpentry, and blacksmithing, and girls be instructed in the domestic arts, the proper occupation and ornament of their sex." He argued that a school would train those who could then instruct others, which would gradually enable them all to become independent of the white man for our intellectual progress, as we could be for our physical prosperity. In a report to the Canada Mission Board, Hiram Wilson explained their reasoning. "This institute is not to rival Oberlin or Oneida, but it is necessary because neither of these is safe for the fugitive. Our arms are thrown open to receive and instruct them, where no tyrant can molest or make them afraid." Oneida Institute, a Presbyterian-supported school near Utica, New York, where students earned their tuition by doing manual labor, had been founded in 1827 to prepare students for mission work in the West. In 1833, Beriah Green, a staunch abolitionist, became its president, with the promise that he could direct the school toward the cause of black freedom, transform the institute into an interracial abolitionist training ground. Given the go-ahead by the Canada Mission Board to find a site that would be safe for fugitives, Henson and Wilson decided on Dawn, where Henson had first wanted to settle. Perhaps he had been drawn to the area because religious camp meetings were held in the flats, the lowlands, near the Sydenham River. Possibly he'd met Weldon Harris and Levi Willoughby, two blacks already living there. In any case, the land was heavily forested with wetlands and grasslands providing plenty of game to support the community. For the school, which had been named the British American Institute, Henson and Wilson purchased 200 acres on the river. Henson bought 200 adjacent acres for himself. The school eventually built at dawn must be credited to Hiram Wilson and James Fuller, as well as to Josiah Henson, though it was Henson whose name would be forever linked to it. In 1842, work began. First the school was built, then a sawmill to generate income from the vast surrounding forests, and a gristmill for grinding wheat and other grains. Soon dawn had become synonymous with the British American Institute, and many blacks were drawn there because of the promise of education and jobs. By 1844, American abolitionists began publicizing the area. Levi Coffin, a Quaker abolitionist from Cincinnati who was known as the president of the Underground Railroad, made his first trip there that year. Others, like Coffin, arrived to see for themselves the status of fugitives they were aiding to escape to Canada. By 1845, the school had 70 students under the tutelage of one of the Institute's first teachers, Hiram Wilson's wife, Hannah. It was a new Fugitive Slave Act, passed in 1850, that served as both cause and effect in anti-slavery opinion. The 1793 law had stated that a slave maintained his status even in states and territories that did not have slavery. But many states did not enforce this rule. Southern states pushed through new legislation, making the federal government rather than the states responsible for enforcement. Historian Eric Foner notes the irony. The same Southerners who had used the argument of states' rights to defend slavery were now demanding federal intervention to help protect those rights. The 1850 law specifically required the involvement of marshals to assist in the apprehension of fugitives and commanded citizens to aid in their capture. It forbade interference with any persons attempting to apprehend fugitives, and it denied fugitives the right to trial by jury, or even to have their testimony considered in court. The harshness of this law, while placating Southern slave owners, resulted in increased abolitionist sentiment and action among blacks and whites. The Liberator, an anti-slavery newspaper, noted that nearly all the waiters in the hotels in Pittsburgh fled en masse 2 weeks after the signing of the bill by President Fillmore. Hiram Wilson estimated that in the first 3 months after the law's passage, at least 3,000 people crossed the border into Canada. Free blacks did not wait passively for sympathetic whites to protect them. Many formed vigilance committees for mutual protection. Abolitionist newspapers appeared.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.